once in a blue moon, I surf through the television channels. Usually I only watch baseball or golf on television, that's it. But once in a while, I'll just go through all the channels and see, you know, what's on. What is going on? And it really was as if I was tuning into a different world, a different planet, an alien planet. Because the themes, the activities, the dialogue, the actions, the expectations, what they were doing, everything, to me was like as if I had stumbled upon some foreign planet that I'm not familiar with, and it's just bizarre. And I'm looking at this and saying, what in the world is going on? Shocking. But not unpredictable. Because when one chooses to remain in deep forgetfulness and be completely irresponsible, one has to, that gives rise to a certain type of behavior that reinforces this. And I couldn't find anything on television that wasn't this way. Everyone seemed bizarre. And their lack of focus was bizarre. I'm not saying that, you know, there's bizarre in some psychiatric disassociative way or nothing. No, it's their lack of focus that's so bizarre. It's their preoccupation with distracting themselves that's bizarre. And just the way that the actors interact and the lines that they're reading, and the whole song and dance is coming straight from severe irresponsibility, severe forgetfulness, severe unwillingness to turn their direction around, which they must do at some point, but certainly not now. So you have this, they call it the idiot box, the boob tube, meaning, you know, if you want to really be dumbed down, watch television. But it's worse than just dumbing down. It's worse than distraction. It's severe irresponsibility. So it basically, it's a training, a template. Television provides a template for irresponsibility. And the actors and the producers and the writers and the advertisers are all collaborating on that. And it's not just mild. It's not just severe. It really warrants being said as if it's like an alien species. We have extraterrestrials here. You can see them on television. It's like a subspecies of drastic irresponsibility. So, of course, those who choose to be responsible are not watching television. Again, like I said, I tune into the Masters Golf Tournament and watch a few nice drives and lovely park-like setting and peaceful. Something like that is, that's not a big deal. The reason why I like baseball is it's pretty much the same as it's been for 137 years. So it's almost like stability, an island of stability within a sea of drastic change. Bases are still 90 feet, pitcher, everything, you know, it's pretty much the same. Bat and the ball, the glove, the grass. Same with golf, it's been around a long time, 400 years or so. And, you know, very little has changed. It's still the same game. So stability, continuity. No matter how much the world is frantically changing around us. Tune into a baseball game and you say, oh, it could be 1974, or it could be in the 60s, or whatever decade, it's still basically the same game. You say, oh, okay, things really haven't changed that much, but it's an oasis, and around that is drastic change. Just turn the channel to go through the other channels, and you just see very, very strange song and dance that it's taking place. Interactions I found to be bizarre. Would never even think of interacting with people that way, the way that's presented on television. Our situation here is serious business. Very serious. Because as I said in the previous video, wisdom culture and tough love, suffering inevitably becomes intolerable here. And when you taste that intolerable suffering, you get very serious, entirely serious. And those people on television are not serious. They're not taking care of business. Our business is to turn towards remembrance, deep remembrance of what we are. That is our inescapable business. Cannot escape it. We think that through death we escape it. No, we don't. Because spirit doesn't die. Death doesn't bring remembrance of what we are. How can it? Just continues the process of forgetfulness, the dance of forgetfulness. Spirit doesn't die. Spirit's not something that is born and then dies, ages, etc. No, spirit is immaculate from the very beginning, perpetually and endlessly immaculate. The death of a body does not remind us of spirit. I saw nothing on television that reminds, has any hint of remembrance of what spirit is, what we are. Nothing. Zero. Just the opposite. I was doing everything possible frantically to enculturate forgetfulness. And the same with all of the culture. We live in a cultural desert. Didn't used to be this way simply because the means of distribution were not there. We didn't have hundreds and hundreds of channels. We had a couple, maybe. Before that, none. So we were not so easily distracted. We could take a book, study a book for 10 years. Very, wisdom book. There weren't all these distractions. There were all these radio stations, satellite stations, television stations, cable stations of all types, constant entertainments and concerts, all these vast empire of entertainment called the empire of distraction. Just wasn't available. So people were much more sober, more serious. And we tend to think that the frivolity of the times is somehow a good thing. It's not. We think that we're living in grand times. We're not. Every day there's a new casino that goes up somewhere. Culture of frivolity are the advertisers for all the programs, and they are trying to enculturate an attitude of frivolity and triviality, which they are. All those shows, the trivia shows, game shows, contest shows, shows are enculturating an attitude of frivolity, non-seriousness, all of which mitigates against the rigors of the spiritual path. And the spiritual path is simply a path of exchanging forgetfulness for remembrance. And again, what makes it difficult is the attempt to accommodate both of those. Forgetfulness is misery. Suffering is terrible. But trying to accommodate both forgetfulness and remembrance, that's a different type of suffering. That's a kind of agony. And one has to pass through that agony. It's virtually inherent within the spiritual path that one will try to accommodate both. Because one doesn't trust either one quite yet. So say, well, just to be safe, I'm going to try to do both. That seems to be the better option. But what it brings is agony. And then one has to have the sobriety, the seriousness, the tenacity, the perseverance to work through that and see what's causing it, and then to realize that one has to choose just one, not both. And this effort is so difficult that it really begs for a supportive culture. And when we enculturate just the opposite, all the opposite attitudes, frivolity, lack of perseverance, focusing on trivia, focusing on silly games, entire enculturation that the world is engaged in now, that mitigates against taking the spiritual path. Absolutely does. When you have all these advertisers representing alcohol and gambling and all sorts of decadent, frivolous pursuits, sponsoring all this entertainment, the shows will reflect the kind of attitude that the sponsors want, which is an attitude of frivolity. Just picture the Titanic, you know, singing, dancing, gambling, gorging out on food, and just having this carefree, frivolous attitude, ignoring the dangers, defying them, so to speak, with this frivolity. So that's what we have now. How can one make their way through that when the overwhelming attitudes of the world do not support the kind of intense, long-term, determined effort, all-out effort to work through the folly of trying to accommodate both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance, and finally realizing that deep remembrance is safe and it's the right choice? How can one do that without, when the cultural support is in complete opposition to that effort? So these are just the facts. One has to realize that we live in a decadent world. Decadent world means a world that is geared towards not making the right effort. It's geared towards avoiding making the right effort. It's geared towards avoiding making the tough choice to say, you know what, it's go time. I got to remember what I am. I have to choose remembrance of what I am. Because forgetfulness of what I am simply goes on unabated, doesn't get me anywhere. It's a waste of time. It's misery, it's suffering, it's futility, it's boring, I'm tired of it. It's time to remember what I am, which is spirit, an idea within the mind of God, extended within the mind of God, but not leaving the mind of God. So everyone has no choice but to do that eventually. This world here, right now, one has to look at it with open eyes instead of sugarcoating it. The idea is to make this world a place that is so superficially pleasant that one will never feel the necessity to remember what one is, really is. It's kind of like trying to make the dream really pleasant. So there's no need to wake up from it. So let's make it all, the idea is to make it all so glittery and glamorous and trivial and with cheap thrills and superficial situations, all this fluff, tinsel, everybody laughing, traveling around, having a good time, you know, eating such very gourmet food, drinks, all the drinks being, you know, super, super great choices in beverages. Hedonistic lifestyle. That's where the world is going. It's actually, those attitudes are entrenched. And we may think that the third world is the savior. Not true. You have to look at that at open eyes too, which I have done. The fact is that when poor third world people get the opportunity to indulge in hedonism, they seize upon it avidly. They only seem to be free of that simply because the opportunity is not there. Not because that they've gone through it and rejected it ideologically and are strictly on the path of remembrance. No, simply they haven't yet had the opportunity. But give them the opportunity, and they jump in with both feet. So there is no salvation there. The idea of a primitive culture somehow saving the world is nonsense. You know, when they see opportunity to be freed from all the drudgery and say, all the superficial appeal of the modern world, they say, wow, this is great. It's only those who have had some taste of all of this, worked through it, and realized, you know what, it's not so great. I was looking on YouTube a video on a famous actor, entertainer, and towards the end of their life, and he started out in severe poverty, very bad circumstances, and ended up incredibly rich, could have anything he wanted. And he is very honest, and he said, you know what, it's the pursuit of all that which is interesting, which seems to have meaning. He says, once you have it, you realize it's really not worth it that much. It's not valuable. It's really not anything that you really thought it would be. All the riches and the fame and things, etc. He says, no, that's not it. You only think it's it when you don't have them. But once you have it, then you realize, oh my gosh, it's pretty much worthless. That's true. So once you go through materialistic phase, you realize, oh, wow, that's not it. And so forget it. You're not so easily induced to continue on with it. So just like at these times, many of us should be wise enough to know this isn't it. But neither is primitive conditions it. Because primitive conditions simply lead back into a thirst for materialistic conditions. It's like someone who drinks too much and they decide to not drink anything. What happens? They get severely thirsty and eventually they go right back to drinking a lot. So that's not a remedy. Going primitive is not a remedy. The remedy, again, is choosing a new idea. Instead of the idea of wanting to be prime creator, choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. That gives rise to the effect of the overlay. And then this overlay is remind spirit of what it really is. It's that simple. 1, 2, 3. spirit has to be reminded, deeply reminded of what it really is, not of what it might be or could be or any of those delusions, of what it actually is. And the reminder has to be spot on. It cannot be some vague, fuzzy, equivocal, uncertain, compromised reminder. That won't do it. That'll simply cause great confusion and concern. Has to be crystal clear, certain, without any exception, reminder. Because how spirit tries to forget what it is to claim that there's an exception to truth, even if it's a little exception. That's all it takes. That opens the door, the floodgates to delusion. So the reminder has to be without exception. It has to be an effect that has no exception to it. One effect, with no other effects interacting with it, or interfering with it, or interfacing with it. Therefore, it cannot be a play of energy. Simply one effect that is unaffected, that is perfect from the beginning, perfectly stable, and endlessly perfectly stable. That's the overlay. That's the only effect which will remind us of what we are. Because we're in a perfect effect of the Prime Creator. That is what we have to remember. Because we have tried to forget that we're a perfect effect of the Prime Creator in order to believe that we are the Prime Creator. And we tell ourselves all sorts of tall tales to believe this. One of them is to say, well, we weren't perfect in the beginning at all. We were evolving into something perfect. Therefore, we couldn't have been created by a perfect Prime Creator. In other words, we devalue the notion of a perfect Prime Creator by claiming that we were not created perfect. We were created imperfect, incomplete, etc. But we will become perfect. That's just a way of dancing around the truth. That's all that is. It's a way of denying the truth. The truth is, we were created completely perfect and immaculate from the very beginning, by a perfect and immaculate Prime Creator. So to say that no, we started out as nothing and we're slowly becoming something, or we started out as a little seed but we're gradually learning and evolving and growing with all of it, shedding all these imperfections, and eventually we'll polish everything up and turn it out to be a diamond. That is how we forget what we are. That is a straight, direct denial of the truth of what we are. That's the story that the mind is telling us. We call this mind doing this, the ego. Mind marketing these delusions to us, as we call it, ego. An ego will never tell us the truth, can never provide for us the effect we need, because the effect we need comes from choosing a different idea. One effect, immaculate, pure from the very beginning, unchanging. That's what reminds us of what we are. And, of course, reminders are indirect. So it's not a direct experiencing of what we are. It's a reminder of what we are. Direct experiencing of what we are is beyond the scope of what we need to consider right now. We only need to consider accepting the reminder of what we are. That's it. Because once we have a perfect reminder of what we are, it's certain that then from there, we will directly experience of what we are. When we're completely attuned and at one and at peace with remembering what we are, we have perfect remembrance, then it's an easy step to directly experience what we are. It's not even a step. It's completely gentle crossfade into what we are. Directly experiencing what we are instead of remembering what we are. But the remembrance of what we are is called the intermediate step. That's the plan of salvation. That's how it works. We take this intermediate step of perfect remembrance of what we are. That's all we need to focus on. That's the entire thing right there. One effect, one overlay. Overlay over everything that arises in the dream of forgetfulness. Sounds, all conditions, all experiencing, all times, places, situations, equally overlaid, just one overlay. Not parts here and parts there, not cobbled together. Seamless. Seamless, one effect, one seamless effect, overlaying everything that arises in the dream of forgetfulness. Simultaneously overlaying it all. Not like painting over it, like brush strokes painting over it. No, it's already completely simultaneously overlaid in one step. So nothing has to be done about it. It's already there in immaculate condition, waiting for us, waiting for our choice, waiting for us to choose to experience it. So you have that on the one hand. On the other hand, you have television culture. Modern entertainment, information culture, tabloid culture. The world has been turned into a tabloid culture. Even those who think they're highbrow aren't really. They're still in the big tent of a circus. So one has to choose. Does one want to exist within the tabloid culture of this planet, or does one want to choose to experience the overlay? Those are the two options that we have. It's always the same. Right now, it's the options are becoming more visible, more clear, more clearly delineated. So it's actually a good time in that respect. You have to look at the positives, and that the world is becoming so terrible that we realize, oh my gosh, there really is a choice that needs to be made. And so our efforts here are to clarify the option of the overlay, choosing the overlay, choosing to abide in that. And there are some who helped us out with that. Okay, we will continue to provide help here through these videos. But for now, that's it.